But because all roads don't lead to Kansai, actually just one, planners designed a myriad of mass transportation to bring both workers and passengers to the airport from all over Western Japan. It's a commuter's dream, and not a smelly cab in sight. Futuristic bullet trains like the Nankai Rapido move you in minutes to Osaka, traveling in style. Japan Railway's metro trains make several convenient stops for commuters who work at Kansai. High-speed ferries bring air travelers from Kobe across the bay. And let's not forget the luxury taxis or the over 20 limousine bus lines that serve Kansai.
It is convenient because I use every time this airport limousine to get from Kobe to here.
To keep an eye on all of these modes of transportation, Kansai's state-of-the-art traffic center is armed with over 40 remote-control cameras. These omnipresent eyes enable officers to monitor and manage everything from traffic jams to emergency situations. But patrolling the roadways at Kansai is really a drop in the bucket compared to protecting the waterways around it. Kansai Airport is surrounded by vast miles of open sea that feed directly into the Pacific Ocean. To keep that secure, airport officials call in the big guns. The Japanese Coast Guard is on duty all day and all night. With their own airport outpost, Coast Guard search and rescue boats keep tabs on traffic in Osaka Bay. Akiyoshi Kabuki heads up the water patrol.
The area around the airport is a regular route for fishing boats. We also have pleasure boats with people enjoying their leisure time. If we spot a suspicious boat, our boat will immediately approach the vessel and will question the crew members over the loudspeaker.
And in an age with terrorists targeting aircraft, securing the sea is the Coast Guard's number one priority.
9/11 was such a tragic event. Since the incident, we have tightened up our security against possible terrorist actions, but I can't disclose any major changes or details on that.
While the Japanese Coast Guard protects the airport and its precious cargo by sea, there are several other provisions to protect the airport on land. Every inch of the tarmac and terminal is captured on a huge network of security cameras. Special security officers surround an airplane while it's at the gate, never leaving the big gals alone. And the runway itself is draped in a high-tech security blanket of ultraviolet light that invisibly surrounds the perimeter. If this light beam is broken, security is alerted and called out to investigate the disturbance. Observing from their perch high above the runway, Kansai's air traffic control operators take command, securing the friendly skies, making sure they stay that way with a 360-degree view of things above and below.
The height of this control tower is decided to be able to see every parking price for airplane from control tower.
Assuring that nothing gets lost in translation, controllers converse with pilots from every corner of the world, safely talking them through the ups and downs of the day. But Kansai Control's record speaks for itself. In 10 years, they've amazingly had only one minor mishap.
Once we have, the aircraft, when the aircraft landing, you say, oh, the runway, and they just start for, it was about 5 or 6 hours. We need to close the airport.
But that doesn't mean they don't get their own share of excitement, because controllers at Kansai have to deal with something they have absolutely no control over, Japan's wild weather. Every year, the Kansai region gets pounded by giant tropical typhoons that can generate winds up to 190 miles per hour, bringing along damaging high tides, not good for an airport surrounded by water that happens to be sinking. Captain Jeff Linder recounts a close call with one wild storm at Kansai.
We arrived, we landed. As we, you know, you can begin to feel the pressure building. The velocity of the winds were increasing. The barometer was dropping. You knew that it was happening. And by the time we left Kansai on the bus, got to the airport, to the hotel, probably an hour and a half later, the full brunt of the storm was upon the airfield. And it blew for hours and hours. And we knew that our sister airplanes coming in, several had to divert. And the airport was closed for that weather phenomenon for quite a few hours.
Helping air traffic controllers steer clear of that kind of disaster are the guys next door in Kansai's 24-hour weather center. Toshifumi Tsutsumi of the Japan Meteorological Agency oversees operations.
We observe the weather here and use our instruments to send the data to the control tower. Air traffic controllers guide aircraft based on the information they receive from us.
Airport meteorologists visually track the weather and rely on sensitive monitoring equipment to update conditions every 30 minutes. That's especially important when it comes to wrestling with Kansai's wild winds. On a gusty day, this unprotected island can give pilots a run for their money. United Airlines Captain Richard Earhart commands a Boeing 777 to Kansai on a regular basis.
When you put an airport in a bay like this, you're going to get winds that vary. As we came down, we had winds that were like 20, they'd be 20 knots off our right wing, and then it'd be maybe up by the nose 8 or 10 knots, and then coming back in the rear, maybe also in a quartering tailwind 19 knots.
The varying winds beneath their wings keep pilots on their toes and the weather and traffic controllers on their feet. But while turbulent weather is always on the radar here at Kansai, safety is too, and everyone proudly plays a part in that, from the tower to the tarmac. If you think of Kansai International as a real city on the sea, then the main drag is its 3,000-meter runway, an asphalt welcome mat to over 150 planes a day. Maintaining this special stretch of road is vital to the airport's entire operation. One pothole, one broken light on this major artery, and business can shut down. But finding time for runway maintenance can be tricky on a runway that's open around the clock. So the work is done at night, in between flights, when it's easier to spot that one problem light out of the 5,000 that dot the runway. And if you're already thinking, ouch, that's some sky-high electricity bill, you're right. Kansai lights up the sky and the entire island to the tune of $37,000 a month. But there's no power struggle here. Airport planners built their own utility facility. The Kansai power plant makes sure nobody's left in the dark. And while we're on the subject of juice, providing jet fuel is a basic necessity at any airport, and a unique challenge for one surrounded by water with no connection to the mainland. But here's one place where an island is ideal. At Kansai's fuel supply center, located just off the runway, huge 4,000-ton tanker ships can pull right in, park it, and pump. The center has four piers for tankers to dock and unload. Jet fuel gets sent from these berths all the way across the island for storage in these huge supply tanks, stashing enough to fuel jets for 7 full days. Now, we all know handling jet fuel can be a pretty explosive situation, especially if you're considering putting pipes under a sinking island. But Kansai's fuel management team had safety in mind from the start. Anticipating the sinking and a few earthquakes now and then, they designed these special serpentine delivery pipes with flexible joints, preventing any tearing or leaking as the ground moves. It's a swift and safe system, pumping fuel underneath and around the runway to jets waiting to gas up and go. You've seen how Kansai covers what goes into the planes, but how about what comes out?
I'm the director of this facility, which is called the Clean Center.
Kansai's Clean Center is a one-of-a-kind incineration plant, handling all the trash coming off the planes and out of the terminal.